Wow, what a privilege to be with you virtually here from the warm, balmy Southeast Asian country of Malaysia. I'm so happy to have this opportunity to share with you for a few minutes. I've known Jay for many years now, and I'm sure thankful for the opportunity to share with you. My name is Paul Elliott. I've been living in Malaysia for about 2.5 years, and Jay asked if I could just share for a few minutes about what life is like and ministry is like here in this part of the world. And so I told him I'd be happy to do that. This is my family. My wife Lindsay, we've been married almost 17 years. My daughter Olivia is just about to turn 16, and Marissa is almost 14. Addison is 12, and Isaac just turned 9 in December. He's a bit of a Christmas birthday there, and so this is our family. You might be asking, well, why would you move to Southeast Asia? And I was serving in a church in Tulsa, Oklahoma, on the pastoral staff there. That's where I met Jay and Ruthie, and what would compel you to take your family and move to a whole nother part of the world? And so let me give you a couple of answers. I could probably spend the whole time just answering that one question, but let me try and do that succinctly here. And as I was there in my pastoral office and studying the scriptures, and I began to see this theme throughout the Bible. And you first pick up on it in Genesis chapter 12, where God is making this covenant with Abram. And he says, he comes to him, he says, I've chosen you and I'm going to bless you. And he really lays out five specific ways. I'm going to give you a son, I'm going to make you the father of a great nation, I'm going to give you a land, and so on. He says, I'm going to bless you for this reason, he said, God says, tells Abram, I'm going to bless you so that you will be a blessing. In other words, you're not to keep the blessing for yourself, it's for others. In fact, in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. That's all of the na all the different people groups of the earth will be blessed in Abraham. We know that's fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And so when Jesus is getting ready to ascend back into heaven, he gathers his disciples around. It should not have come as a surprise to them that this is what Jesus would say, because it's all through the Bible. In fact, the Bible says over 1,700 times that God, his name, who he is, will be made great among the nations. That is, all the families of the earth will be blessed. And so he gathers his disciples and he says, listen, all authority has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all, you could say, the families of the earth, of all nations. Teach them who I am and what I've taught you, and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and so on. We know this as the Great Commission. It's given five times for us, once in each gospel, the first chapter of Acts as well. So I began to see this in these other times in Scripture, and then I saw this at the end of the Bible as well, in Revelation chapter 7, where we see that the whole effort of missions is actually completed. And God has determined and decided that people from every tribe and tongue and nation will hear of who Jesus Christ is and will believe and follow him. It's like the task is guaranteed, that the purpose will be fulfilled. And so here, John the apostle sees men and women from every tribe, tongue, and nation gathered around the throne of God, worshiping before the Lamb, worshiping Jesus Christ. And so that it was like this light bulb that went off in my head as I saw through all of Scripture this theme of God moving through history to bring people from every tribe, tongue, and nation to himself. This is a little bit of what the world looks like today. I got on Worldometer, and over 7.8 billion people are walking on planet Earth today. But 6.8 billion of them, approximately, have no concept of who Jesus Christ is, or they have chosen not to follow him. In fact, over 300, or I'm sorry, 3 billion of them actually don't have any access to who Jesus Christ is. There's no church that's among them. There's no missionary that's trying to reach them. They may not have the Bible in their language or any other kind of literature. Even if they wanted to know about God and who Jesus Christ was, they wouldn't know who to ask or even Jesus' name so that they could Google him. That's a significant problem, given that Jesus commissioned his church to go and make disciples of all nations, all 17,443 nations. When the Bible talks about nations, it's not talking about a geopolitical entity that's surrounded by borders like we see between the United States and Canada or the United States and Mexico. A nation in the Bible is ethno-linguistic groups of people that are distinct in their culture or their language or their ethnic diversity and background. And of those over 17,000 nations, there are 7,400 of them that are considered unreached with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The task of missions is still needed. Missionaries are still needed. And so our objective here in Southeast Asia is to come alongside the national church of Malaysia and of Myanmar and of Indonesia and the Philippines and Singapore and these Vietnam, these different countries of Southeast Asia, and to help the Christians see the need of reaching the people who've never heard. In the entire existence of that people group, no one from their past generations has ever known who Jesus is. Somebody has to go and introduce them. And so, 80% of the missionaries come from places like North America and Europe. But 80% of the Christians live in places like Indonesia and Nigeria and Brazil. But only 20% of the missionaries are coming from those countries. And so the mission field that we see as like Brazil and Nigeria and the Sudan and Indonesia, the mission field is really a mission force. There are millions of evangelicals that could be mobilized for the task of missions. That's our objective. And so here we are living in Southeast Asia. We live in the country of Malaysia, but Southeast Asia is made up of some 11 countries with 675 million people, with at least 40 million Christians, followers of Jesus that live in this part of the world that could be mobilized for the cause of the gospel in the world to peoples that have never heard before. And so here is just to kind of give you some perspective. You see that circle there, more than half of the world's population live inside that circle. When I began to understand that there are more Muslims that live inside that circle than outside of it, and there's more Hindus that live inside that circle than outside of it, and there's more Buddhists that live inside that circle than outside of it, and there's more atheists inside than outside, and then I realized that there were these millions of evangelicals that live inside that circle. Then this is probably the most strategic place I could think of living for the sake of the gospel, to mobilize the church for missions here in Southeast Asia, so that they would go to some other culture, some other people group to share. So that red arrow points to where we live in Malaysia. This is our city. This is Penang, also known as Georgetown. We're looking down from a kind of a jungle mountain, Penang Hill, a very popular tourist place to visit if you're ever in the city, and looking down over our island and city over towards the mainland. You see there across the water, mainland Malaysia. And so Penang is known as the foodie capital of Southeast Asia. We have a massive diversity of food here, and we love it. We actually have loved living here in Southeast Asia, and there's just so much to explore and discover and try, like this three spice sauce that is poured over an entire fish that's put down on the table in front of you, or this chili crab, or this seafood stew. Yes, there is a lot of seafood, a lot of chicken and beef and pork as well, but Seafood seems to be kind of what is so unusual here. And so here you see a spread of vegetables ready to go on the grill and some baby octopus to put on the grill. And yes, Isaac, my son, did attempt them and he actually enjoyed them. None of the rest of us had the courage to stick one of those chewy seafood pieces of gum into our mouth. But anyways, this gives you a kind of a picture of the diversity of food, but we also have a wide variety in our population in Malaysia. And so that has led to a lot of very common food. And so I can drive down the street and I can get a Big Mac from McDonald's. I can order a Domino's pizza or a Pizza Hut pizza. I can go down the street and eat at Chili's restaurant and Krispy Kreme donuts. So we have a large variety of Western foods and Asian foods that we can enjoy here and anything else in between. So, for instance, my wife and I went out for a date the other night to a French restaurant and enjoyed that food very, very much. So here is some of the diversity of people that we've been able to engage with. And this is our family. We had the chance to go to Myanmar. This is the long neck people, a tribal people that beauty is found in the length of the neck, and so they put on these brass rings, and it pushes the clavicle down, and kind of gives the idea of a long neck here. And so the longer your neck, the older you are, but the more beautiful you are. And so many different cultures. Or we get to go to places like the Philippines and engage with mission leaders there and eat at TGI Fridays and enjoy people from all kinds of different cultural background. Or go to one of the wealthiest cities in the world, Singapore. And here you see this massive hotel. It's very famous on the skyline of Singapore and some of the things that we've been able to enjoy there as well. But our city is known for its street art, where famous artists have come along in the old British buildings and they've painted this art and added an actual artifact like this old motorcycle to become a part of that art. And so one of the popular things to do here in Penang is to do a tour of the street art in our city. And you see my son there, Isaac, on the motorcycle with this little Malay girl who's become just a very good friend, and her family are good friends with us from Kuala Lumpur, the capital of Malaysia. And it's one of the great blessings of living in a place like this is your friends come from so many different backgrounds and your relationships from some such a variety of people. And so this is a city where your tea or your coffee can come in a bag, where the hospitality and the smiles of the local people are just warm and engaging. And also where you can interact with people from all kinds of different religious backgrounds. And here is one of the historic mosques, Muslim mosque in our city, with the Malaysian flag there. And so about 60 to 65% of Malaysia's population is Muslim. And in fact, as you saw earlier, more Muslims live here in Malaysia and in Indonesia than any other part of the world. And so it's a great opportunity for sharing the truth of Jesus Christ. It's also a place where you just might be going down your neighborhood street and see the friendly neighbor's cow just kind of meandering across the street, or rather than seeing a warning for deer crossing the highway as you would in Indiana or Oklahoma, you might see a sign that looks like this. And yes, you should be cautious if you're driving on highways in Malaysia. Hitting an elephant is not nearly as fun as you might think. But perhaps the greatest highlight and blessing of being in a place like Malaysia is the incredible people that we get to spend time with from all of these different countries that we call friends, that we call ministry partners, that we have the opportunity to disciple and share and do life with. These are men and women who are heroes of the faith, who are growing in their faith and are giving of themselves for the sake of the gospel. And so it has truly been a blessing to be living in this part of the world and to be serving the Lord in this capacity. So again, thank you for the opportunity to share and introduce life and ministry in Southeast Asia. And I hope that one of these days, you and I will be able to meet face to face. Until then, God bless and have a great rest of your day at school.